How was Louis Vuitton invented? Nowadays, it's common to see people working extremely hard to dress in branded clothing. Celebrities like rappers have marketed designers' items in music videos and song lyrics, leaving their fans with the urge to be like them. A few people have even gone so far as to paint their homes and automobiles in the theme colors or emblems of these brands, or tattoo themselves. Associating with these labels might make some individuals feel wealthy, but for others, it's merely a way of life they can afford. Louis Vuitton, one of the world's most famous companies, will be the subject of today's video. Before we go further into today's video, I'd like to urge you to subscribe if you haven't already. Like the video, comment, and share as well. Don't forget the notification bell for future video updates. Not many people are aware of this brand's entire name, but I'll tell you right now, since I'm here to entertain and educate you. The brand's full name is Louis Vuitton Malati. However, it's more generally known as Louis Vuitton, or LV. Louis Vuitton started the French fashion house and luxury products firm in 1854. In addition to luxury trunks and leather goods, LV offers ready-to-wear shoes, watches, jewelry, accessories, sunglasses, and books under the LV monogram. So far, Louis Vuitton is considered a leading worldwide fashion brand. The brand Louis Vuitton was named after the founder, and it retains his name even after some centuries have passed. So, who was Louis Vuitton? He was born on August 4th, 1821, in Anchet, a tiny village in eastern France's Jura area, which is covered in mountains and densely forested. Many of his forefathers were joiners, carpenters, farmers, and milliners. His father Xavier was a farmer, and his mother, Caron Gaillard, was a milliner. Vuitton lost his mother when he was 10 years old, and his father married for a second time. According to stories, Vuitton's new stepmother was as cruel and vengeful as any stepmother from a Cinderella story. Vuitton, a rebellious and headstrong boy who was enraged by his stepmother and bored by life in the provinces of Anchet, decided to flee to the busy city of Paris. At the age of 13, Vuitton left home alone on foot, heading for Paris, on the first day of bearable weather in the spring of 1835. He walked the 292-mile journey from his hometown of Anchet to Paris for more than 2 years, working odd jobs to supplement his income and living wherever he could find shelter. He turned 16 in 1837, amid an industrial revolution that had generated a litany of contradictions, awe-inspiring magnificence, and abject poverty, fast expansion, and deadly diseases. Vuitton was hired as an apprentice at the workshop of Monsieur Maréchal, a famous box maker and packer, when he was barely a teenager. Box making and packing was a highly prestigious and urbane craft in 19th century Europe. All boxes were custom made to fit the contents they were storing, and the boxes were personally loaded and unloaded by a box maker and packer. It only took Vuitton a few years to establish himself as one of the city's foremost practitioners of his new art among Paris's stylish elite. Napoleon III became Emperor of the French in 1852, 17 years after Louis Vuitton landed in Paris. Napoleon III's re-establishment of the French Empire was extremely fortunate for the young Vuitton. His Spanish countess wife, Eugénie de Montaigu, employed Louis Vuitton as her box maker and packer. As the Louis Vuitton brand grew into the world-renowned luxury leather and lifestyle brand it is today, this offered a route for Vuitton to a class of aristocratic and royal clients who would demand his services for the rest of his life and well beyond. As with every firm, there comes a point when it's time to make a significant shift. Louis Vuitton encountered a 17-year-old beauty named Clémence Emilie Perrieux in the year 1854. Henri Louis Vuitton, his great-grandson, later said, "He transformed from a worker's cotton dress and hobnailed shoes to the day's courting costume in the blink of an eye." Because Louis' shoulders were much broader than those of Parisian bureaucrats, The change was dramatic, and it took all of the store department manager's expertise. That spring, on April 22, 1854, Vuitton and Parieu married. Vuitton quit Monsieur Marechal's store a few months after his marriage and started his box-making and packaging ware shop in Paris. Outside the business, there was a sign that read, "Packs the most delicate items safely." Packing clothes is one of their specialties. Louis Vuitton was created in the Rue Neuve des Capucines in Paris, France, by a master luggage manufacturer. The starting price for Louis Vuitton was $10,567. The H.J. Cave Ocelyte trunk was stacked according to Louis Vuitton's observation. Vuitton's flat-top trunks with Trianon canvas were invented in 1858, making them lightweight and watertight. Before the advent of Vuitton's trunks, rounded top trunks were utilized, which couldn't be stacked since they were designed to facilitate water runoff. For journeys, Vuitton's gray Trianon canvas flat trunk allowed them to be easily stacked on top of one another. Vuitton's style and design were eventually replicated by several other luggage manufacturers. He introduced a completely new trunk 4 years after starting his store in 1854. The trunks were an instant commercial success, and as transportation and travel became more widespread, demand for Vuitton's trunks grew. To meet the demand for his baggage, he opened a bigger workshop at Agnières, a hamlet outside of Paris, in 1859. The business was flourishing, and Vuitton received personal orders from Ismail Pasha, Egypt's Khedive, as well as French nobility. Unfortunately, in 1870, the start of the Franco-Prussian War and the ensuing siege of Paris, which led to a terrible civil war that destroyed the French Empire, severely harmed his company. With the war raging, Vuitton returned to Agnières a year later to find the village in ruins, his staff scattered, his equipment taken, and his business ruined. Vuitton committed himself to restoring his business after finding it entirely in ruins. This was a huge accomplishment, since he was able to repair the shop in only a matter of months. With the new address came a new emphasis on luxury. Rue Scribe, which was home to the famous jockey club and had a much more aristocratic atmosphere than Vuitton's former location in Agnières, was located in the center of New Paris. Vuitton debuted a new trunk style in 1872 with beige canvas and crimson stripes. The new style was basic yet beautiful and appealed to Paris's emerging elite and heralded the start of Louis Vuitton's present incarnation as a luxury brand. When Vuitton died in 1892 at the age of 70, his family was going through a difficult period, and his son, Georges Vuitton, was named the new leader of the luxury business. After Louis Vuitton's death, his son decided to modify the print on their luggage once again, and in 1896, the distinctive LV monogram was created, patterned with LVs, étoiles, and flowers to commemorate his father. Success ensued under his leadership, and the distinctive monogram became well known among the upper crust. With this growth in popularity, the brand attracted the attention of one of the most well-known fashion icons, Gabrielle Chanel. Almost a century later, in 1925, Chanel designed a dome-shaped handbag intended for personal usage rather than travel. Chanel didn't let the company mass-produce the bag for the general public until 1934. It was called the Squire until 1955, when it was modified to be more compact and streamlined for everyday usage. Louis Vuitton expanded its product line to include Keepall, 1930, Speedy, 1930, and Noe, 1930, as a result of the popularity of its smaller items, 1932. The demand for these bags was so high that they're still being produced in a variety of fabrics and sizes. When Georges Vuitton died in 1936, his son, Gaston Louis Vuitton, took over as the manager. During Gaston Louis's 50-year career, Louis Vuitton began incorporating leather into its goods and redesigned their distinctive monogram canvas for usage in a variety of designs. When Gaston Louis died in 1970, the firm was taken over by his son-in-law, Henri Recamier. Henri saw the need to expand the brand's reach and pushed for the opening of retail stores all over the world. In 1984, the company went public at the suggestion of finance director Joseph Lafonta. The decision opened the groundwork for the ultimate parent conglomerate to be formed. With Louis Vuitton as the top luxury goods business, it was only natural that they would team up with the major champagne and cognac producers, Moët & Chandon and Hennessy, respectively, to form the LVMH conglomerate in 1987. This was one of the most significant events in the company's history, as well as a power move. When the company expanded to a worldwide scale, it became well known and idolized. Since then, it's grown in popularity and has been voted the world's most valuable brand for 6 years in a row, 2006 to 2012. The brand is currently valued at $47.2 billion, with sales exceeding $15 billion. And that's all for today. Thanks for watching. Please leave a like, subscribe, and don't forget to turn on the notification bell for more amazing videos. Also, feel free to comment your thoughts below and share the video with your friends. Goodbye. See you in the next video.